Hello, art historians. Welcome back to Art History. This is Late Europe, and we have recently finished our stroll through the early part of the 1900s, and we're going to switch into a unit on abstract expressionism. And so we sort of think, we have to think a little bit about a couple of things. To think about the expressionism we heard before, which was really about emotion and stuff like that, Kandinsky. And then we need to think a little bit about things that are abstracted. And the push here is for us to move into a kind of art influenced by Kandinsky that typically we're looking at as being post-World War II art. So it's influenced by the atrocities of World War II. It's typically like expressionism, focused on intense emotion. But abstract expressionism has a tendency to lead more towards what many of the artists of the time called subconscious creation, really getting at emotional intensity through painting very quickly with in that instantaneous moment of strong emotion. And that strong emotion has a tendency to lean towards things that are rebellious, anarchic, you know, leaning towards anarchy, loss of rules, that sort of thing. And so we're looking at art that is really about focusing on some of the broken pieces of society and what that does to the human subconscious and how the broken pieces of society and human subconscious can create a certain type of art. Now, abstract expressionism is typically considered to be a United States thing. And that's one of the most important things. We're dealing with mostly, almost completely American artists here. And so, you know, that is the other thing is expressionism is more of a European thing, where abstract expressionism is a little bit later in time and mostly an American thing. So that's the definition of our abstract expressionism. So we're gonna move into the first piece by an artist named Willem de Kooning, whose name very much does not look American. And that is because he was born in Rotterdam, Holland, in the Netherlands. But he moved when he was like 21 or 22 to the United States, became a United States citizen, and lived in the United States for the entirety of his life. And so when he was doing his artwork, most of his career took place in the United States. He was married to an American artist. Her name was Elaine Fried. While he was originally European born, he is considered usually an American artist because he moved to the United States when he was so young and did almost all of his work while he was here. Woman One, that's what you see there. It's not Woman I, it's Woman One. This is one in a series of six paintings that depict sort of this abstract expressionist artwork. We're also dealing with a time period where we're thinking about what is called action painting. And again, I talked about this, it being painted very quickly. And it is the way of focusing the subconscious by working quickly through your work. So this is a series. I mentioned that he was married to a fellow artist named Elaine Fried, but they were very unhappily married. It was not a positive relationship. There was a great deal of fighting and arguing. They cheated on each other regularly. And there were a lot of really, you know, just sort of bad feelings between them and strong feelings between them. One of the feelings being love, some of the other feelings being hatred, mistrust. So it was not a really a positive relationship for either of them. De Kooning was trained as a classical artist. He was, his training was, you know, in the traditional classical masters and stuff like that. Before he entered formal training, he did some abstraction on his own. And then he goes to school. Excuse me, I have terrible allergies right now. And it's it's got my my throat itching. Excuse me. So this is sort of like, what's interesting about this is he did abstraction. He then did his, you know, traditional classical training. And this is when he returns to abstraction after being fully trained in sort of the way that we do, air quotes, real art, end air quotes, because this is real art. But he felt he needed that formal training first. And then after he has his training, he returns to, as I said, abstraction with a series of works that are focused on the human figure, predominantly the female figure. So there are a lot of questions here about how much of this artwork is influenced by his unhappy relationship with his wife, especially in the way that she is depicted. Her face is ugly. Her teeth are aggressive. Her breasts are prominent, but they are not painted in a way that looks attractive. Her head seems almost skull-like. Her legs seem to be almost animalistic, close to like hooves. It's aggressive in its construction. And as I said, look at these pieces on the side, very clearly this action painting, painted quickly. He did not create this series to sell. They were really like studies that he was doing. So he kept them mostly for himself. They now have sold. Woman 3 sold for, I think, $150 million. It's one of the most expensive paintings to ever sell. What's interesting is when he painted this, they can use like 3D imaging and infrared imaging to see that this canvas had multiple paintings underneath it. And he would paint them and then sort of put turpentine on and remove the paint and then paint again and remove the paint and start over. And it's clear with this particular one, woman one in the series, that he was trying to accomplish a particular style. And considering the fact that there are multiple works underneath this, we assume that this is the style he was attempting to get at. When we look at her, she is definitely a break away from the classical nude. But when we look at her, she also sort of feels sculptural. She almost sort of feels three-dimensional. With the disproportionate breasts, she feels a little bit Venus of Willendorf-y. There have been many, many interpretations of this piece. The most common interpretation is that it is misogynistic. It is a negative depiction interpretation of a female. And a lot of that comes from, you know, knowing his history with Elaine Fried. You know, there's a comment on the idea that this could be what they call a bastardization of a World War II pinup. What I want to show you really quickly is what else was being painted at the time that this was being painted. Because while de Kooning was painting this, Mark Rothko was painting this, which is called a color field or color theory. And it's the idea that your brain processes colors that are next to each other in a particular way. They've just started cleaning outside. I'm going to go close my window for a second. I'm still here. I'm just going to close my windows to try to block the noise. I'm still here, still closing windows. Got one more window to close. I can't get that last window closed, so it's going to be a little loud. Sorry about that. So Mark Rothko is doing this color field. Rectangles of color, colors that contrast. It was a study in the way that your eye moved along a canvas and interacted with color. So this is one of the things that was happening at the time that de Kooning was painting Woman One during action painting. This is another thing that's happening at the time. Okay, this is Jackson Pollock. This particular piece is called Number One Lavender Mist. This is that drip painting, splatter painting. He would put the canvas on the ground. He would go up onto a... they're called cherry pickers, kind of like a crane kind of thing. And he would drip paint and then he would squeeze paint. And, you know, there's just this idea that of this action painting. Now, what's interesting is there is no purple involved in this work at all. But the overlaying of colors gives it sort of this hint of purple. Okay, so those are two of the things that are happening at the same time that de Kooning is painting Woman One. Those are not in your AP curriculum, but they're interesting to look at, especially when we see that abstract expressionism can be Woman One, Color Field by Mark Rothko, splatter paintings by Jackson Pollock, and this one is in your curriculum, or The Bay by Helen Frankenthaler. So what's interesting about this piece is this is another one where we can group it in with the Last Supper in the idea that it is flawed materials. And I'll talk about that in a minute. But it's a really cool organizing or collecting theme. Frankenthaler, your artist here, was also married to another abstract expressionist artist, Robert Motherwell. And so, you know, again, we get another one of these relationships. Jackson Pollock was married to another artist. That is an interesting thing that happens here in our more contemporary art, is the idea of artists being married to each other. Or maybe it's just very simply that now women are creating art. So Frankenthaler created this in 1963, and you're going to notice that unlike some of our other works, right, Oil on Canvas, we see here with Frankenthaler's The Bay, we see that this is in acrylic. And that's a very modern, contemporary material. So, you know, another theme could be, you know, new or changing materials. This is huge, you know, 6'9" by 6'10". It's almost a perfect square. And what's interesting is this painting was part of the Venice Biennale. And I think I've talked about that, the big art show that happens in Venice every couple of years. If I haven't talked about it, I will talk about it in much more detail when I do our site art in our next video. Here's the thing. Acrylic paint has a tendency to be kind of pasty, right? You pour it out and it's kind of like comes out in like almost like a paste. And the problem that Frankenthaler ran into was that she wanted her acrylic paint to be more fluid, To have less, the word is viscosity. Viscosity is like the thickness of the fluid. And so what her method of construction was, is that she would take a canvas and put it on its stretcher. And then when she had the canvas ready, she would put the acrylic on the canvas and sort of move the canvas from side to side, back to forth, like just kind of move it to get the paint to run into each other. And I mean, you can see that. You can see the movement here, this dark, dark blue that sort of bleeds out into this lighter blue. Definitely she bleeds the green in first. Now, what you need to really think about is acrylic paint doesn't really do that. So how did she get this acrylic paint that she wanted to be able to twist and move to be able to blend and run from this very, very dark indigo to a lighter blue and a navy down here? How was she able to do that? Well, what she did was she added turpentine to the acrylic paint. And she did not prime her canvas first with like gesso or anything to fill up the holes. She used like raw canvas and she put turpentine in the acrylic, and she then would tilt and lift the canvas to allow it to flow where she wanted it to. And then the acrylic would, color the canvas. The problem is, and if you've ever painted, the problem is that you know that turpentine eats away at paint. And because she didn't prime her canvas, and because she used turpentine as her base, what is happening to all of her paintings is that the acrylic turpentine stain is getting into the canvas and actually causing rot. It's a really, really difficult situation for art historians and art conservationists, because they've got to figure out how to stop the degrading of the canvas underneath the stain. I always like to do a shout out to any students who love art and love science, that, you know, going into art conservation is really a wonderful mixture of art and science. It's all of these wonderful ways of figuring out chemically how to stop this this process that's happening to this. It's how to reconstruct pieces that have broken in a way that preserves their original structure. Art conservation is an amazing, amazing, amazing profession, and they are like the heroes of the art world, and they are unfortunately like the unsung heroes of the art world. A lot of people don't like really pay enough attention to the work that they do. All right, moving on. We're going to move to pop art. Pop art, the term, like pop music, the term, comes from shortening the word popular. So this is art that is used to do a couple of things. It is meant to challenge the idea, again, of what fine art is, of what traditional art is. And you'll see that that's a recurring thing that we see. We see this over and over again, artists wanting to challenge the idea of what is, what is traditional, artists trying to challenge the idea of what fine art is. And so in our, our pop art here, we have a tendency to lean towards things that are, the word is, The word is kitsch, and I will talk about what kitsch is significantly more when we get into contemporary art. But things that are sort of almost tacky, and that is where we sort of go with pop art, because a lot of the images are taken from popular culture, like ads, comics, television shows, things like that. Okay. And so, you know, our pop art, pop art is really, for the time in the 1950s and 60s, very, very contemporary. The two most popular pop artists are, I'm going to show them to you really quickly, Roy Lichtenstein. You may have seen pieces like this. This is the Hirshhorn Museum in DC, and there's a giant sort of like paintbrushy kind of sculpture out in front. And the other most popular pop artist is Andy Warhol. And so this is a piece called the Marilyn Diptych. And we've talked about diptych and triptychs before when we were doing all of our altar pieces back in the Renaissance. And a diptych is a work in two parts. And this is oil and acrylics and silk screen. And so what silk screen is where you take a mesh, like a screen, and you block off part of it with like a stencil, so that like the paint can only go through certain areas. And then you put the screen on top of the canvas and you push the ink through the screen and onto the canvas. And it goes onto the canvas where that decal isn't. And so what he would do is he would make a screen that would be just for her blonde hair, for her purple face, for her blue here at her neck and her eyes, and for the red at her lips, and for the black shading. Okay. And so what's interesting, though, is that as you use a screen for silk screening, the more you use it, the more degraded it becomes. And so the more the image looks less real and becomes more faded. And you can definitely see that sort of here on this corner, the side of her face here, where the color just comes in too much. And you can see here where the screen gets used and it doesn't let enough ink in. And here you can see it let too much ink in. And so what you're looking at is Andy Warhol was really about taking over common images in popular culture and also working them together with art history and creating images that both feel old and new, images that feel both real and imaginary. And so what you see here is a work that was created in 1962, shortly after Marilyn Monroe died. Marilyn Monroe was famous for being an actress. She was famous for, they believe she had an affair with President Kennedy. She committed suicide, and there have been lots of conspiracy theories that she was actually murdered by the CIA or the Kennedy family to try to her name is connected to just all of this craziness, right? And so what Warhol does is he takes this image of her, and he sort of does something very interesting with it, which is he takes two canvases, and I want you to look at how big they are, 81 inches by 57 inches, okay? So it's 5 feet wide, 5 feet high by, 81 inches, what is that, 6-7 feet? And so you're looking at, when you first look at this, it's one of those pieces where you think to yourself, like, it looks small, right? And then you do the math and you're like, but it's almost 7 feet long and 5 feet tall. It's a gigantic piece. And so he takes these canvases, he silvers them, which means he sort of covers them with silver paint. And then he silk screens on top of them this image of Marilyn Monroe. And half of the images, 25 of the images are the color, and the other 25 of the images are the black and white. But what's interesting is he takes a pre-existing like stock image of her. It is not a photograph that he took of her. It is sort of this, you know, just common stock image that was used for like, you know, advertising movies or whatever. And he uses that purposefully because what he wants the viewer to look at is this idea that we had this amazing talent, Marilyn Monroe. She was incredibly talented. She could sing, she could dance, she could act. I mean, she was very, very talented. And often directors, you know, cast her as sort of the dumb blonde, but she was significantly more talented than that. And so what he does is he takes this stock image of her and he depicts her in a way that we do a couple of things. First, it's a diptych. Diptychs are typically religious. In the medieval the medieval period, a diptych would be used to worship God. Here, Warhol uses it as a way to worship our idol, our icon, right? So he is trying to show the influence of popular culture. It doesn't have a particular focal point. Unlike a lot of other art, you're meant to look at a particular place. This does not have a specific focal point. Your eye continues to move around, okay? It's this idea of repetition or seriality, the idea of showing the image over and over and over and over again. It's the idea of the play between light and dark and complementary colors. It is the idea of the repetition of her image, taking it from being beautiful and seductive in some of these early pressings that are really beautiful to being sort of flat, eerie, almost inanimate, a cartoon. Here she looks more real. Here she looks cartoonish. But with the silkscreen, as the shading and things like that disappear, over here on the black and white area, we take her from feeling like a person to this dark form, then to the disappearing. Okay. She becomes less and less real. She becomes less and less animate. She becomes less and less of a person and more of sort of a one-dimensional image. It should make you feel a little bit like a film strip. The more we get into The more we get into the repetitions of her, the less emotion she seems to have, the less personality she seems to have. And it is because she is becoming more and more ghost-like, more and more corpse-like. She is disappearing. This is life and this is death. What is amazing about this is part of a series that he did called Death in America. And there are a ton of images of car crashes, you know, people who have died. Just it is a way of documenting how, as a culture, we respond to the death of famous people, and of how, as a culture, we sort of ignore or embrace death, depending on who it is that is dying. This takes talent. While it is a silk screen of an existing photograph, the idea of being able to imagine this is so outside of any kind of art that had been seen before. This is absolutely a social commentary on how we see famous people and how we treat them. It's a little bit of blame on pop culture that possibly the way that she was treated resulted in her suicide. It is just a revolutionary way of creating. And I think that Warhol doesn't get enough credit for how sort of crazy out there his work is, but that the crazy out there-ness of his work required so much talent. Andy Warhol was, he worked at an ad agency, so he was drawing, you know, famous ads for important companies before he decided to become an artist of, you know, in his own right. And he was incredibly talented in his creation of advertisements. So, you know, he is wildly underappreciated, in my opinion. That's just my opinion, though. And I think that when we look at the art, when we see his art, we too often think about, oh, I could have done that. You know, he did the whole series of Campbell soup cans. Well, sure, you could have done it, but he did it first. And so I think that is one of the things that we need to think about. All right. So while we're in pop art, we're going to move into our next image. Excuse me. I have such a scratchy throat. The work they are doing is mowing, and it's kicking up all kinds of grass and everything. It's just irritating my throat. I'm really sorry. Okay, so now we're getting into sculpture. We haven't seen a sculpture in a while. You know, we've been doing all of these buildings and paintings, and it's been a while since we have seen a sculpture. I think the last sculpture we saw was probably the Burghers of Calais back in the Romantic period. So, I mean, we really haven't seen a sculpture, you know, in 150 years almost. It's nice that we had the kiss during Surrealism. I forgot about that one. Yeah, we did have the kiss. Okay, so we have had a sculpture. Never mind, ignore me. So this is by Klaus Oldenburg. And this is called Lipstick Ascending, going up on a caterpillar. Sometimes it says on caterpillar tracks. Sometimes it says on a caterpillar. It depends on where it's been listed. So it has a couple of dates here. And the reason is that this is the second version of it. The first version of it was created in 1969 by Klaus Oldenburg. And then the second version was created in 1974 by Klaus Oldenburg, and we're gonna talk about why. Okay, so you're gonna look and you're gonna see that it says Core 10 steel, which is a new kind of steel. Core 10 steel is a new steel that was invented that was corrosion resistant. It's weather resistant, and Core 10 steel is really a big deal as far as, you know, outdoor installations of art. Regular steel would rust and things like that, and Core 10 steel is significantly less likely to corrode or rust or whatever like that. Then we have steel and aluminum and cast resin. And then it is painted with a polyurethane enamel that would then sort of seal everything up. So it's created in its second version to be much more weather resistant and to be able to be outside. It's located on the campus of Yale University, which is in Connecticut. And it's 24 feet tall. It's huge. What's interesting about this is in 1969, Klaus Oldenburg and a bunch of architecture students at Yale created the first version of this. And the first version of this wasn't meant to be permanent. It was like an overnight installation. They went out, they put it together, they left it in the middle of the quad, and it was there for like 10 months before Yale approached them and were like, look, we really like this and we want it to be a permanent installation here. So we're going to need to have you make us a new one. And that's why we have two different versions. We have the version that was made in 1969. And then we have the version that was finished and installed in 1974 of the more weather resistant materials. And what's interesting is that, you know, it was put there, it was put there as a social commentary. It was put there as an anti-war demonstration. And in its construction and put there in this anti-war demonstration, we're dealing with the Vietnam War here. In its attempt to, speak out against the Vietnam War and to be edgy and bring the attention of people to the horrors of what is going on in the world, we get this piece. And Yale believed in it so strongly that they commissioned him to make a new one. And so I think that that's really an important thing that we think about, is that that we really think that sometimes when you make this artwork to make this, you know, edgy political statements, sometimes it becomes a statement that a lot of people agree with, and then it becomes something that that we keep. So this was an anti-war platform. This was them protesting against the Vietnam War. The very first one had the lipstick was sort of like inflatable, and the bottom was made of wood. And as it deteriorated, you know, like I said, it was constructed to last longer. Klaus Oldenburg, he's still alive, by the way. This is 2021. He's still alive. Oldenburg is known for large outdoor installations, and typically his sculpture is often like giant replicas of everyday items. He was also married to an artist. And so when we think about the kinds of things that he creates, they're meant to the same as Warhol, meant to sort of bring out the beauty of everyday objects, but also in this particular one, see the beauty in everyday objects, and then really think about what those objects represent. And so at the time of the Vietnam War, we have tank. It looks like a tank, and a giant lipstick. And so what we're looking at is sort of that the juxtaposition, the fight between masculine war imagery with female imagery. This takes that, you know, at the time there was both a national obsession with war for some people, but for other people, life was going on as normal. We were selling makeup and making movies and having, you know, these glossy magazines with women in them and fashion. And so he's sort of trying to point out the futility, like the uselessness of both war and this sort of over commercialization of women's fashion and things like that. And so he wants you to think about, the idea that war is dangerous. And so is, ignoring war and going on with, life as usual. He wants you to think about the idea that lipstick also kind of looks like a bullet. He wants you to think about art that is meant to get you thinking about what's going on in the world and what you're going to do to change it. get your head out of worrying about how pretty you are, what makeup you have, what you look like, dating and stuff like that, and start thinking about the deadliness of this war. And if you're thinking about your lipstick and being beautiful and all that stuff, just simply by ignoring the war, you are helping it. Oldenburg once had made a comment about how that, and it has a bad word in it, I'm really sorry, but that art is meant to, and this is his quote, do something other than sit on its ass. It needs to do and whatever is necessary. And what he wants you to do here is he wants you to think. And the backdrop to all of this is the idea that young men were dying at an alarming rate because of the Vietnam War. Some people argue that his inclusion of this piece at Yale University, which is a place that only really wealthy people could attend, the idea that going to college was often a way that men could get out of the draft. Some people argue that this might have not have been the best place for this piece, but he felt very strongly that you needed to be doing something to bring attention to, you know, this horrific war imagery and or war that was happening. What's astounding is that it was created in 1969, and the war continues, I think, until 1973 or 74. I mean, it was bad, and you know, people lost friends, and he was really trying to say, like, stop worrying about love and beauty and fashion and think about, you know, what these boys are doing. So that's him. That's Roy Lichtenstein. I told you about him. He's famous for creating these sort of comic book pieces. That is the end of abstract expressionism, mostly American, and pop art, also mostly American. And I will see you next time for sight art, art that is specifically created to be outside and meant to reflect, to be seen specifically in its location. So I hope you learned something. I hope you had a good time. And I'll see you next time for our last episode of Late Europe. Bye, guys.